The following program was taped in front of a live web audience and has been edited down for timing. It contains mature content, explicit gaming coverage, and a girl.
This week, Splinter Cell Conviction, Ebert flips game developers the bird, Nikole's top seven strippers, and we get down with the classics. It's all coming up on The Game Show.
This episode of The Game Show is brought to you by Netflix and Gamefly.
Let's go!
What?
Yeah!
Hey, Friday night, welcome! It is The Game Show live on thestream.tv. Unless you're watching the edited version on Rev3, we encourage you to do both. We do this thing for about an hour, we chop it down to half hour, goes up on Rev3. Tonight, it's gonna get sexy. What's up? I am Jim. We are gonna be talking a little bit of Splinter Cell Conviction for you guys tonight. And joining me, as always, in the purple square, the lovely Nikole Z.
I will be in the stickam room with my stickers, and I will also be monitoring the Twitters, so you can Twitter us at The Game Show TV. And guess what I'm gonna have tonight for you? Yeah, top seven list.
Tonight we're talking a little bit of Nerd on the Street. Roger Ebert's got some talk about video games art or not. Well, maybe we're going to change Roger Ebert's opinion a little bit with a new bit, Jim.
Cheers to that. It's called Getting Down with the Classics.
What is Getting Down with the
Getting
Classics?
Getting Down with the Classics is going to be a lovely artistic dance number. I believe in the studio we want to cut right now to our good friend Janessa is in town from San Diego. Janessa, welcome to The Game Show.
Say hi, Janessa.
Yay! Let's get into a little bit of combo, some quick hits of news that you might have missed from this past week, starting off with Alan Wake as seen on TV. So on XBL, there is a live-action prequel coming. So we got a little bit of footage for that. It is, it's a prequel to the Alan Wake video game. It's gonna premiere on Xbox Live Sunday the 25th, that is this Sunday. It's called Bright Falls, after the town that the game takes place in. The preview video, it's got a definite creepy Twin Peaks-y feel to it. The series is gonna play out over 6 episodes, and it's gonna wrap up a day before the game's May 18th release date.
I don't like when they show the faces of people in live-action video game trailers.
Why?
It's just weird. It just doesn't ever feel right.
What do you want to see?
Well, maybe just like the
hands.
Illusion.
Hands,
shadows, yeah.
Fingers, maybe fingernails.
I don't understand. I don't understand your complaint.
That guy is not Alan Wake. He's just an actor. Alan Wake is the guy in the game.
Okay, fair enough. But it's an actor portraying Alan Wake.
It's not
him. I don't know why you have
Ruined
a problem with this.
Magic.
Because I didn't get to make that trailer.
Oh.
Use games at 7-Eleven. 7-Eleven has joined forces with Game Trading Technologies, that's a convenience store chain, to start selling used games at 7-Elevens. The games will run you $20, which is approximately 12 Slurpees, guys. Do the math. Do the math. I did. The promotion.
You have a Slurpee conversion button on your calculator?
No, it's an app on my iPhone.
Oh,
no,
of course.
Yeah, it's free. Look into that.
Good.
I'm lying. The promotion will be known as Great Games Under $20. Oh, makes sense. And it will be available in half of the country's 7-Eleven, which is approximately 3,000 stores. The CEO of Game Trading Technology said, what this means to consumers is that they will have many convenient locations, most open 24/7, to buy value-priced games. You can also buy a chili dog and a Slurpee with your game. Oh my god!
You can also buy beer! 7-Eleven is coming out with their own beer!
I'm still just trying to think about, like, what it would be like if we actually measured the value of things in Slurpees. I think that's, like, a much better way to add stuff up. What we got is for me here, Smash Brothers Brawl Balanced. This is great news. Here is a free hack for your Smash Brothers game on the Wii. It's a fan-made mod that balances the game. What I'm talking about is it's going to fix the overall character balance, remove infinites and inescapable lockdowns and juggles. Increases the stage viability overall. And it's not a permanent hack. All you need is an SD card and a PC. That's what's pretty sweet about this. It's not gonna change the physics of the game, the character speed, any of the playability stuff. It's just like the way that you know Smash Brothers, just a little bit more balanced for competitive play. And it's not illegal because it's a non-profit venture that even though it affects copyrighted files, it's not gonna allow you to distribute anything that's gonna circumvent the copyright. You can check it all out at balanceforall.net. I really applaud what they're doing. I wish there was more stuff like this.
Maybe this will encourage it. Maybe.
Halo beta bragging. Halo, Bungie is calling, they're predicting that there are going to be around 3 million beta players for the upcoming Halo Reach beta. According to the studio, that's a conservative estimate.
That's a lot of people.
If you put that in perspective, the Halo 3 beta had about 800,000 beta players. So this is well over three times that amount they're anticipating. I mean, there are jetpacks. Yes, but is that enough to warrant such high expectations?
It has the name Halo in the title. There is the high expectations.
But again, Halo 3, not to say only, but had 800,000, and now you're talking about a conservative estimate of 3 million?
The 360 did just hit 40 million people is in the install base, 40 million consoles. So that is a lot, so maybe it's not that conservative.
Wow.
That's like 1/40th or less, right?
The real question is, will they get a promotional Mountain Dew? Mitten Dew, I mean.
Mitten Dew?
Mitten Dew. All right, so DSi Fast Food Training. The lovely country of Japan loves their Nintendo DSs. That's a fact. And now the McDonald's chains in Japan are using Nintendo, or McDonald's rather, branded DSs. There it is, and it's nice DSi, to train their employees. And the new segment they said it's so popular, it's going to make learning fun. That's how popular this is.
Good. Games, learning is so boring.
The games are very Cookie Mama-esque, and you can learn to assemble a quarter pounder, or I guess, what is it called? A Royale with cheese? Is it that there too?
Sure.
You learn to assemble, you learn to fry, you can learn to cook your space, clean your workspace.
Leave it to the Asians to figure out how to cook with sticks. It's McDonald's!
It's very complicated, as you can see, and actually, they're claiming that this is included. The pace of making burgers, and they encourage their employees to play this on the weekends.
Okay, that's great. Tony Hawk Shred was slipped up a little bit of announcement this week via Twitter from Tony Hawk himself.
Uh-oh.
He was tweeting, Tony Hawk Shred, there, I said it. Actually, I named it. Somewhere a PR team is reeling. Yeah, of course they're reeling, because this was a stunt. He leaked the name of a game that they have no details about. Activision pulled down the tweet, or they made him pull it down, and then a couple days later they confirmed that, yes, that's the name of the game. There won't be any information for it for a few months. So there you go, Tony Hawk Shrug.
Oh,
he did it! Yes, he did.
We don't know if he uses the Tony Hawk Ride peripheral, but what was interesting to me is the new Shaun White game from Ubisoft is going to be a skateboarding game. So now Tony Hawk might be making a snowboarding game. I'm assuming that because it's called Shred. I mean, it has to be.
Cats and dogs living together, mass hysteria. That just makes no sense.
Fun fact for you, Shaun White was the only guy to win gold medals in skateboarding and snowboarding in the Olympics.
That's a fun fact.
In summer.
And that's Combo.
Hey now.
Gamefly, you know it, you love it. It is the largest online video game rental service, and it offers you a choice from over 7,000 new and classic titles across all consoles and handhelds.
With plans starting as low as $15.95 a month, Gamefly members can rent 1 to 4 games at a time.
It's easier to use than four.
I'm sorry, what?
Yeah. There's no late fees, there's no due dates, and shipping is always free.
And it's going to be around for a lot longer than it's my turn. Once you're done playing a game, you can send it back and Gamefly will send you the next available game on your list.
If you really like the game you're playing, you can go to their website, click keep it, and the game is yours for a discounted price. They're even going to send you the box and manual free of charge.
All you gotta do is just go to gamefly.com/thegameshow and you're gonna get a 15-day free trial from us. Helps us out, helps you out, everyone wins. It's a really solid service.
All right, let's do a little bit of Nerd on the Street.
Yeah, we're running late.
Now, there was a little bit of flap. Roger Ebert, on his blog for the Chicago Sun-Times, was talking about how video games can never be art.
It's a stupid debate. And he's just being an old curmudgeon. I mean, I gotta say, there's his article up on the Chicago Sun-Times.
This is a tired debate.
Here's the thing, he has free time. He can be playing some of these games.
No, he doesn't play video games, that's the thing. He said right now, no video gamer now living will survive long enough to experience the medium as an art form. That's bullshit, I already have. Yeah. I've definitely had experiences that took me someplace, they transported me, they made me think about things, and enjoy someone else's creation.
And you have somebody who admittedly does not play games, is you know, way behind on the times, so how can he possibly make that argument? I mean, you talk about something like, shout out Willie Shakespeare, happy birthday. Shakespeare isn't something that you just pick up and you go, oh, this is brilliant. It's like you have to learn, you have to take a class or what have you, somebody teaches you. What is it about Shakespeare's writing that makes it art, that makes it so classic? And you, that's not something you could necessarily discern yourself. And I think the same thing goes for video games. Like, it's not something you know, it's something you learn. And if you're not even willing to immerse yourself even a little bit into the medium, how can you possibly make the statement that video games aren't art?
Art isn't something that you necessarily even need to learn that much about to appreciate. I think if you can experience art and you feel something from it, and something, someone created this, and you can, you know, feel something from it, and you don't need to learn that, and either way, he hasn't experienced it. He hasn't even attempted to understand. And he said it back in 2007 when he originally brought up this topic of video games art. He said, anything can be art, even a can of Campbell's soup. What I should have said is that games cannot be high art, as I consider it.
Oh.
So now, I mean, he's just changing his words, and he's arguing for the sake
of
arguing.
It's semantics. It's semantics. And Kelly Santiago really said the best thing about it, which was that Ebert seems to lump art, artistic, and artistically crafted all together. You can look at something like Little Big Planet or Braid and say that it's artistic, but you might not call it art, where I would look at Kelly Santiago's game Flower as being extremely artistic and still art, having a purpose. I think all that stuff is really important. This dude is 67 years old. She knows that he hasn't played games, so his opinion on the matter isn't really relevant. Of course, the mainstream media ran with the story. Condom 3000 in the room saying, Ebert's old, let's leave the old guy in the past.
One of the jobs of the critic is to keep a sense of like the cultural, like just the cultural norms and rules.
And he's lost.
And he's, yeah,
he's
it's
clueless.
Just, he's behind. And it's okay. It's just, it's time to move on. The game of the week is Splinter Cell Conviction. It is the latest. Nicole is holding up the box art because she is beautiful.
My
the
job.
Box art is beautiful.
I like my job.
Keep it together, Jim.
Sam Fisher
it's
is.
It's just a poll.
Back.
It's just a poll.
Now, I have not. I know. I'm very distracted tonight. I've not played any Splinter Cells before. Guides, give me, as a noob to the old Splinter Cell, give me a quick rundown about what this series is about.
Well, Splinter Cell is a stealth game, and if you have not played a stealth action game before, like Thief, like Metal Gear, basically you're creeping around the shadows, you're looking for the dark spots, you're creating dark spots, the dark is your friend, and that is what you will use to humiliate, punish, destroy your enemies. A lot of people in the rooms, I got Chicken Lord here saying Batman.
Yeah.
Yes, Batman was, for a lot of people, the first stealth game that they enjoyed.
And honestly, I didn't even realize it would be considered Batman anyway, a stealth game. I didn't feel like that was stealthy, like where Splinter Cell definitely to me just screams stealth.
But the cool thing about it is that a lot of times in stealth games, it's stealth to avoid being detected, whereas in Splinter Cell, it's stealth for the purpose of stalking and killing. The code name that everybody's using for you, that you're the target, these guys are trying to track you down, is Panther, which is awesome because you are a panther. You're a stealthy, svelte, sexy little panther, and you are shooting fools, doing quick moves, dropping from pipes, breaking necks, shooting out knees. I love this game. There's positives and negatives about it. When you're in shadow, the color drains from the screen, which goes to black and white, so it lets you know that you can't necessarily be seen. The cover system in this game is fantastic. You basically use the left trigger anytime you're up against an object. Even if you're in the middle of the floor, you pull the left trigger, he's gonna get as low as possible to avoid detection. The cover system works really, really well.
Alduin, are you gonna mention the part where stealth isn't nearly as important in Conviction? We just did. Yeah, it's definitely the actionifying, the streamlining, if you will, of the stealth genre. Nicole, did you find it fun?
I did find it fun. I'm definitely not a stealth type of person. That's not my type of game, and it definitely relies on the stealth. But again, like Jim was saying, the cover system, I didn't get stuck to cover, mm-hmm. which in Mass Effect 2 and in Gears of War, those games are all about cover, and I got stuck to the cover a lot, and that didn't happen with the game. It was very smooth. What I had trouble with was getting used to the controls. It took me a while because the controls for this game aren't like any game I've ever played. You push like L3, the left joystick, to reload, and I've never done that, and I swear it took me forever to get used to it.
Nikole, you were saying that just as a casual, or, you know, actually you're a pretty hardcore FPS player, the whole notion of when the color would drain to black and white, that actually kind of throw you off because you associate that with losing health.
Absolutely. The first few times where it would fade to black and white, which means you can, you know, you're not seen, so you can easily kill people, I would freak out because to me that meant my life was low. And so I would seriously start to panic, and then I'm like, oh wait, calm down. I can jump off the wall now. Stop hiding.
Yeah.
It's good.
Also, like Batman, where the color drain, or not the color drains, but it changes and it becomes more monochromatic, you kind of lose, I think Nerdalicious Core or somebody, I forget your name, I apologize, was saying that you do lose a little bit of the beauty of the game when you do step out into the light and the game kind of lights up. It's like, oh yeah, this looks really, really good.
I'm going to say buy it. I mean, the story mode didn't have me hooked right away, but the co-op and the multiplayer, you're going to keep playing this for a while. I do want to say that there's a scene in co-op where you can interrogate someone, and by that I mean that you can beat the shit out of them. And there's a scene in a kitchen with a sizzling hot pan, and you can't, you know, throw the guy's face into the sizzling hot pan.
Ooh. But you can beat up a girl.
You can slap her around.
Pros and cons.
Grin. I think this game is a buy. I do. I think there's a lot of value in it. I think the story is, like, Ubisoft's always taking chances with presentation. This is one of the more memorable ones, even if it's not the most challenging stealth game you've ever played. And the co-op is super cool. I'm going to be playing that for a while. A good split-screen game that I can play with my roommate, awesome.
So I would say at least rent, because it is... The regular playthrough, I feel like, flies by pretty quickly. Again, the replay value, though, is pretty high. Co-op, if it lives up to what everybody is saying, it's definitely a buy.
Guys, it's Brian here. Let's talk Netflix. Get movies and your favorite TV shows delivered right to your door. Sign up now and start streaming all of Netflix's amazing content right to your PC or Mac. You can even watch right on your TV with your gaming console. Stream as much stuff as you want and keep the DVDs as long as you want and never worry about paying a late fee. You can support the game show just by signing up for a free trial. You get an entire month free when you go to netflix.com/gameshow. If you don't use our URL, you'll only get the 2-week trial, so make sure to use ours for the full month.
Tonight's top 7 strippers.
7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1!
Hey everybody, it is Friday night and you're here with us. Unless you're watching the edit, and then I want to know, why weren't you here Friday night? Where were you? Why didn't you return my text messages?
Wow.
Guys?
Theo Servi is correcting you. It's top 7 dancers.
Stands okay. Corrected. Sits corrected?
I'm sitting, and you're wrong, because it's my list. So...
Damn. It's as cold as ice.
Point being, your Friday night is going to be spent amazingly, and you're not going to go to the strip club because you're with us. And I'm, you know what? We're going to bring the strippers to you. Top 7 video game strippers. All right, number 7 are the girls of GTA. That's Grand Theft Auto for all you nubbins. All right, the Grand Theft Auto series is nothing if not for its strippers and the ability to kill said strippers. That was a hot 7. Just so you know, a stripper you can beat is a stripper you should keep.
Wow.
I wrote that.
Really distracted by Janessa.
There's a lot of distractions going on tonight, guys. With each dance, the level of skill increases. Third dance, Squeeze's favorite.
The third dance is the money dance.
Yeah, it's
the third
money.
Dance gets a lot better than the first dance, just so you know.
That's what he says.
And patience.
Number 6. Number 6 are the burlesque girls from the Sabatier. Maybe you're feeling something a little more old-fashioned, a little more classy, and I'm talking burlesque. That's definitely the classy.
Yeah, that's our audience.
Yeah, classy, class. The girls of Saboteur are gonna make you feel, you know, good about yourself. Do we have a video of that? Yeah. I just want to say this is probably one of the best graphically.
Wow.
good for those game designers is all I'm saying.
Those are nice butts.
They did well.
Number 5 is Bayonetta. Bayonetta, her two favorite things. She's a big fan of the dancing. She's a big fan of the killing. And she's managed to dance and take off her clothes and kill things at the same time, which is definitely something that she should be very proud of. A lot of her moves, the climax moves, no joke, involve her taking off all her clothes, which are actually her hair, so she's naked, killing things. Number four is Madison from Heavy Rain. When we reviewed Heavy Rain on the game show, we may have left out this part. I don't know why we opted to do that, but we did. And in Heavy Rain, as Madison, you have the option of stripping with this guy, Paco. Not the nicest guy.
No.
Kind of sleazy. You have it. You can, depending on your choices, choose not to actually show boobage. But why would you want to not do that?
You can also choose to fart in his face.
You know that would that's an option.
I just want to get back to the point where you're screaming, Jizzle.
Really? You'd rather skip the stripping part and go back to the...
Yeah, you'd rather
that? We didn't even show the boobies then.
Oh.
We didn't even show the boobies, guys. Jizzle. There are some.
Watch the edit.
There are some boobies.
Rent the game part.
Yeah. G-fly it. Number three is Kelly and the Asari from Mass Effect 2. In Mass Effect, there is not really much of a shortage of dancers around you. And, Yeah. When you're a 50-year-old Asari, you pretty much have your whole life ahead of you. So what else are you gonna do? You're gonna dance. In Omega, Space Vegas, you can dance all you want. But also, if you choose to romance Kelly, you're a crew member, she does a little dance for you wearing the same outfit as the Asari. Kind of cute.
Dick Nam in the chat room is wondering, how did my hand get in my pants? And Dingo Ender Zoe really likes your skirt, Janessa. Dingo Ender. Yeah, lack thereof.
Well put. Number two are the ladies of Duke Nukem 3D. Most people think of Duke Nukem as a guy who's just going to, you know, defend from monsters and aliens, and also apparently strippers.
Never be in a game again.
Yeah, it's coming, the game's out there.
Sure.
But you can throw money at the strippers and have them dance for you, and then you have the option of shooting them, and then their ribs, that was a rib cage. So that's what you do in Duke Nukem.
Wow.
I don't approve of that.
No. Just
tip. Number one is the women of Dead or Alive Extreme Volleyball 2. Yeah,
wowza.
So if that game wasn't as provocative enough, if you go to the casino and win a jackpot nine times, you can unlock the pole dancing sequence for every single character in the game. All those girls who usually like to, you know, climb trees, innocently just climb trees and ride giant whale rafts, now we'll actually pole dance for you.
Turok 64 says he can see your boner.
Wow.
Yours, Nicole, not you.
You're not very familiar with the female anatomy.
All right, community check-in. We love when you guys talk to us on the forums. You've got Stream.tv forum, Rev3 forum. Come talk to us on either. First up for me, I believe, is it's all iTunes related. Sean O says, thanks for the heads up. He meant to subscribe a while ago, but it's always slipped his mind. Edit. Well, you guys have your first review on the Canadian iTunes store.
Oh my God.
Just noticed the review only goes to one store. Do you guys see those ones as well? No, we don't see your dirty Canadian reviews, but thanks.
I was checking in on the Revision 3 forum. You can check us out there. And Torx commented that Nicole's 7654321 countdown bumper reminds me of a vintage Sesame Street 321 from PBS learning shows. Is that where the idea came from? No, but I like to think that we're equally educational. And Singing in the Dark commented on our last week's episode, the best of episode. He says, this definitely caused me to stop down and watch the Golden Girls when I saw it on TV today. By the way, the intro is indeed a shot-for-shot remake of the actual one. If you haven't already, sync the two up for some good laughs. Genius, Jim. Pure genius.
Thanks, Sagan.
It is shot-for-shot for you.
Also on the Rev3 forum, we got that there. He's glad to see the show come to Rev3. It's been a while since he watched on the stream, but he's now completely stopped watching all the other Rev3 shows and subscribing now. Dude, you don't need to stop watching the other shows. I mean, that's cool if you want, but like, there's other good stuff out there. There's way more informative stuff out there. There's good game programming on the Totally Rad Show, on Bite Jacker,
yeah,
all of that.
It's Getting Down with the Classics!
Oh. This is what they've waited for.
Oh, yeah.
I love this.
I think the website's gonna crash. Yeah!
Yes!
Everyone stop typing and pay attention.
Number ones, we get it.
Vanessa's got the moves!
Best segment ever?
I will agree with that.
look at me.
I defy you. Go anywhere else on the internet. Where are you going to find dancing girls and Mario?
Yes.
Can we mention that she actually loves video games?
Luigi grinding. Eddie22 is giving you a virtual dollar. Dick Nam. No, Mom. I'm not watching porn. Leave me alone. Altoid, throw her a one-off.
Where do we send the bill? You guys can donate to the stream. Janessa used to blog with Nikole. She does know a lot about games. She's not just here to dance. She actually knows her shit.
Yeah, she used to write for GamePro.com. Part of GamePro.
The evolution. This is the greatest thing since Golden Girls. It's just as sexy. All right, it's sexier.
Her and Dorothy, close time.
Where are you up to gonna find this live on the internet? This is happening right now.
Hemoglobin's retinas are melting. And Coryell remembers that level.
LOVD wants to know where your daddy touched you. That's not appropriate.
But you read it anyway.
You know what? Tumor makes a good point. It'd be better without Queens and Jim talking.
Seriously.
Let's shut up.
Nikole, keep talking.
Oh, me? Is my voice gonna help? Sierra hits it. Or Sierra says, it's blocked.
They love you. Super Flash is a willing doer for life.
Collectively, you're welcome.
Yeah, you do dance like a white person. We should do for just a second dancing
Parker
like a white person.
Parker said, doesn't Nikole's mom watch this?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. We have achieved my dream. I have nothing else to do. I don't know if we can even go on with the game show anymore. How do we top
yeah,
this?
Next week, hamster races.
Basketball, the most pointless segment ever. Yet the greatest segment.
No, we are getting down with the classics. We are appreciating the
arts of art. Video games.
Yeah, sure.
Wait, dance is considered art?
Yeah.
It's totally art.
Yes.
Yummy Jesus juice. Man, is this where our donations go to? Sweet.
A Nun Turtle, this is very artsy. Iji Kalamajam, best segment ever.
Give Ebert a heart attack. Turok's wiener just leveled up.
Oh, guys, thank you so much for joining us tonight on the game show. We'll be back for another week. We're bringing this back. You know we're bringing this back.
I guess this worked, yeah.
Yeah, you guys loved it. Janessa is awesome. We can't wait to have her back on the show. Join us next week. I am Jim. We will see you till then. Nikole?
Thank you for joining us, everybody. Buck a beak.
Everybody, it's Queens. I want to say thank you so much for checking us out. We are definitely going to do this again. I think this is a big hit. Janessa, take us out, please. You are awesome.
Yeah!
Yeah!
Oh, yeah!
Look at her go. Look at that speed running out.
Do that again.